Both cameras are recording, microphone is on, and we're ready to go. So, we will start with, just tell me your name, what branch you're in, and what you did in the military.
Okay, my name is Tom Logan, in the Marine Corps, Sergeant in the Marine Corps, and I was a forward observer and radio operator with a 4.2 mortar company of the 7th Marines, 1st Marine Division.
Okay. Adjust this microphone, and then we'll get started. A little more. Perfect. So, what? When did you go into the Marine Corps?
I went into the Marine Corps. I went in the reserves in about 1948, after the Second World War. And I was in a Marine unit when we got called up for Korea. In fact, I actually volunteered to go back in on active duty before they called the reserves up. And then we thought we were going to be instructors when they called the reserves up. But we got down to Camp Lejeune, and we took the reserve unit from Philadelphia down to Lejeune. We thought that was working out very well. We were going to be instructors, but then we were told not to unpack our gear, that we were combat ready, and we were leaving for California.
How old were you at this point?
At that point, I'm like 23, 24 years old. And we went out to California, and somewhere around Texas we became, we were in the 2nd Division at that time at Camp Lejeune, and somewhere around Texas we became the 1st Division, which was I was very happy with that. We went out to Camp Pendleton and formed the 7th Marine Regiment. And from there we went to Kobe, Japan, and then we were already combat loaded, so we left early for the invasion of Incheon. And we were with the advance party with the 7th Marine Regiment. Colonel Lichtenberg was our commanding officer. And we made the landing at Incheon during the second day of the actual landing. And we got ashore, and the tide went out, so we had our mortars ashore, and we didn't have any ammunition for them. So I went to the beachmaster and told him, what we were doing. So he sent us over, and we became part of the infantry until the next day. We just took a defensive position until we could set up our 4.2 mortars.
So before we go further into Korea, I want to step back to before you joined the military. A big moment in your generation was Pearl Harbor. Do you remember where you were?
At Pearl Harbor, I was at 41st and Walnut Streets in Philadelphia.
So you remember the exact point where you were?
Yes. And I didn't know where Pearl Harbor went. And I said, oh. And from there, at the time, and I was in high school, and it just became like, at that time, everybody was going into the service. And I had about 6 months to go in high school, and you could go right into the military, and then you got credit for those 6 months. So that was a break for me. That's the only way I got out of high school.
So Pearl Harbor, that stirred something in you to join.
It was just the thing to do in the neighborhood. Everybody went to service.
Did a lot of your friends go in?
Oh yes, and the Army, Navy, and Marines. Even some went into the Merchant Marine. We didn't consider that service, so. But they did.
Why then the Marine Corps?
like the uniform. But a couple of my friends were, they had gone in the Marines and they seemed to like it and everything. So a lot of fellows were going to the Navy, and so we said,
do the Marine Corps.
Why not? Do the Marine Corps.
The uniform is actually a pretty common answer.
Oh yeah. I know. That's why my wife married me.
All right. So what did you know about the Marines then beforehand? Did you know that they were, did you know about the reputation that they had?
They had a good spirit of corps, and, good background and everything, and everybody seemed to brag about being a Marine. So.
Did you have any idea what you wanted to do? Did you want to go into mortars, or did you just...
No. I ended up in communications to start with. And I just stuck with communications throughout.
And, in terms of war, were you ready to go fight? Did you have any idea what war actually was at that point?
I did not know what war was, but we were ready.
So, did you fight in World War II as well?
Yes.
Did you go to the Pacific?
Pacific.
At what point did you get to the Pacific?
It was in 1944, and I guess it was in the South Pacific, Palau, there's Okinawa. I had a side trip to Borneo.
Nice little reprieve, I guess.
Right? Yeah, that was just a small operation there.
Go ahead, I'm sorry.
Oh, and then after Okinawa, we went to North China. At the Tenzin, Tsingtao, visited Shanghai. But we were right in the North China area, off right by the Yellow Sea there. And actually, I was in Korea. We went to Korea, and Incheon was then called Jensin. And I guess it was. It was one of the poorest countries I've ever seen. Like, there was nothing there. The Japanese had stripped them of everything. They had nothing. In fact, I have a book from the Korean government that shows before and after. I mean, now it's a big city, like Seoul.
So little did you know, in five years later, at that point, you'd be...
No, I did not think I would be back there at all. And we were actually, when Korea broke out, which was June 25th of 1950, we were on maneuvers down Little Creek, Virginia. And that's when this other fellow, a couple of fellows, decided that, well, they were going to be calling the reserves up, and that if we would get a leg up and be instructors. Didn't work out that way, but just as well. I don't regret it.
What was your job in communications?
Radio, and I was familiar with a semaphore and things like that, and flashing light. I could handle everything like that.
So your job then would be to, were you in the field with a Marine unit and radio back to headquarters?
Oh, yeah. And then as a forward observer, we go out in front of the lines. In fact, in Korea, in South Korea, they had what they called a supporting arms command. And I represented the 4.2 mortar company. Then we had somebody from the battleship Missouri, 105 millimeter howitzers and 155, and we had a major that was in charge of the whole operation. In fact, we had somebody from the air wing also there, a pilot, and we would go out in front, and he, Major, would coordinate the whole effort, picking targets for us, and he'd tell us, like, all right, 4.2 mortar, there's any personnel sector so-and-so, and I would bring the fire into that area. And then he'd say, all right, Missouri, you know, all right, Navy, let's go. You bring the fire in here. And we do that until Bonnie said, all right. He said, somebody, they found out where we are. So we have to get out the best way we could. So he would just snap his map case shut and said, all right, you're on your own. He said, all right, fly guy. He said, bring your planes down. And we put up markers out in the, they'd have planes up on station, and they would come down, and we would get back to our lines the best way we could. Usually had a rifle and go with us. And
not many people know the job of forward observer, but it's been called one of the most dangerous jobs you could have.
It was probably not just. Being a plain old rifleman, that's the most dangerous job. And it's not just a plane. I always respected the rifleman. In fact, we were all basically riflemen to start with.
That's the way the Marine Corps works, is you guys riflemen first, and then your job, whatever you're trained up to do, is secondary.
And it's very apparent in Korea that when we were the chosen, that whether you're a cook or a baker or whatever, you were still a rifleman.
I do want to touch on, you mentioned some significant islands earlier, Peleliu and Okinawa. Were you part of the invasion of both of those?
No. We were there, while the fighting was going on and everything, but not in the invasion.
Both of those, a lot of people remember Iwo Jima for the ferocity of the battle, but also for the flag raising. And that's actually the anniversary of the flag raising was a couple of days ago.
That's right.
Peleliu and Okinawa, Okinawa specifically, were even, if not as brutal, even more brutal than Iwo Jima.
And that the landing at Okinawa was almost unopposed. It was a soft landing. And they didn't really run into trouble until later in the operation there.
At what point did you arrive on those islands?
I had to be well into the invasion. I'm not sure when. That was 65 years ago, 70 years ago.
You came in more towards the middle of the end of the battle. Were you in the field at that point? Did you go out and were you part of the fighting on Peleliu and Okinawa?
Not really, no.
Okay. And then after the war, did you move on to the occupation, or were you in China? You said you were in China.
Yeah, that was occupation of China.
Okay.
And it was kind of cold up there and everything, but it wasn't like Korea today.
So. And I guess then World War II officially ends. You know, you finish your enlistment, and after the occupation ends, you're sent home.
I came home like in about January, February of 1946, and then we got out.
What's it like to
the reserves.
What's it like to come home after being at war for? At that point, 3 or 4 years.
It was good to see everybody at home. Didn't get a job right away, but.
But how long did it take you to join the reserves then?
Oh, I joined the reserves right away when I got it.
What? Why? Why would?
Just to keep in contact. That's all.
And at that point, is that when you switched from like a radio man to a forward observer?
No, I really didn't. Change there until actually on the ship going over to Korea. I didn't have anything to do, so I just paid attention, got involved with the Forward Observer. Okay. They just needed somebody from communications.
After coming home from World War II, did you? I mean, that had. How did that affect you? As going in as this, you know, an 18-year-old, 17 or 18-year-old kid, now you're a couple years older. Did your, you know, did that change you at all?
I don't think so.
Did you think you'd ever have to go back to war?
No. No. A lot of fellows, maybe they had a bad time with it. I didn't have a bad time with it.
So, I guess we'll fast forward a couple years, and you know, I'm sure you started to hear rumblings about, you know, Korea and these issues happening overseas again. Did you think you would, you know, you mentioned you wanted to get a jump on it and hope to be an instructor.
Instructor, right.
So you had to think, we're going to go to war again, and
We thought we could be instructors and be good instructors. And it didn't bother us that much when we got called back, you know, put in regular line companies.
Well, how long into Korea then did you go? Did you? I don't remember if you said you went right at the beginning or.
We went in, not at the beginning, we made a landing at Incheon. The brigade had landed at Pusan down in southern Korea, and then they came out and joined us, and or we joined them and landed at Incheon.
Not many people are familiar with the Korean War. A lot of people understand World War II and Vietnam to some extent. Can you, I guess, kind of quickly describe the what was Korea? What was the Korean War? What was involved, and why was America over there?
It was probably the first real test against communism, and the communists had invaded South Korea, and they essentially said we had to stop them there, you know, or else they would just continue on. And we didn't know what we were going to. We first ran into the communists in China. And a lot of people don't know that after World War II, the Marines had all out firefights with the communists. They would try to keep trains going from the Peiping at that time, and the trains would be stopped by the communists, and they would just have all-out firefights with them.
So, when you arrived in Korea, what was Korea like?
It was, like I said, it was very, very poor country. Japanese had stripped everything out of them. Anything could be used. They had nothing. They had basic. They still used horses, as plow horses, and worked on the rice paddies and things like that. But they absolutely had nothing there.
Did it remind you a little bit of the, you know, Okinawa and those islands, or was it entirely different?
No, it was entirely different. Those islands still had. They were better, a lot better off than Korea, actually. The people were.
So you arrive in Korea, kind of walk me through what kind of happens next? What unfolds in Korea?
After Incheon, we moved up and the attack on Seoul. We crossed the Han River, and we were supporting the 7th Marines, the Marine Companies. And we went up to a little town called Injongbu. That was right above Seoul there. And then that's where we stopped, right by the 38th parallel. We weren't allowed to go across the 38th parallel. But then we just stayed there. Then we got word that we were gonna come back out and make a landing above the 38th parallel in Wonsan. And what was happening was we were told that they had a lot of prisoners of war, and they were trying to take them across, into Manchuria, and that's what we were trying to stop, and we made the landing at Wonsan.
What was it like in Korea? Was it, the weather was...
Down south it was hot, and you had flies during the day and mosquitoes, and then when we went up to Wonsan, it started to get cold and it was dreary and miserable, like it does, gets around here sometimes.
So I guess we'll move on to the battle of the Chosin Reservoir. Before we talk about what you did, can you describe the importance of that battle, or why is this such an important part of the Korean War?
Well, it was actually when we first ran into the Chinese, we first ran into the Chinese on very early November, and they had said, our leadership said that we were not, there was no China would not come into the war. So we were just trying to go up there and stop our, consolidate our forces at the river up there, the Yellow River, and then the war was going to be over. And there were still some North Korean units trying to get back, and they were going back and forth up there. They were just trying to consolidate our forces there and then home for Christmas. In fact, after we first ran into the Chinese, we ran into about a division, I guess, and we just stayed after they attacked us, and they overran our, actually overran our mortars and everything. We just dug in and stayed until the next day, and we got our air support, and they didn't like that air support.
So your job as a forward observer in the battle, what do you remember from that battle?
I guess when we first ran into the Chinese, I was up with one of the companies, and you can see a lot of activity.
Go ahead, I'm just making a quick adjustment.
I just saw a lot of activity, but nothing to speak of. And then I was relieved, and when I was coming back down, then by the time I got back down, it was dusk and night, and that's when the Chinese hit us, with bugles and drums and whistles and bugles. And so I went back into what we call a fire direction center to see what was going on, and they had a blackout tent set up so they can have lights, and the way it's configured, no light will come out. We had a fire mission from one of the companies, so we didn't have any response from our mortar, so then one of the runners went down to see what was going on with the guns, and that time they were overrun by the Chinese, and somebody said that actually it was a reconnaissance officer said that he came along, gave me a BAR, and said, you protect the, don't let anybody come through that the one area. And this other sergeant was behind me, he was with the ammunition, said if they come in, they'll be coming through this area. And we were up out all night. And we didn't know at that time, but we were getting machine gun fire from the top of the hill there. And that was our machine gun, but we didn't know it. So they were firing down on us, and then I would open up with your automatic rifle, and until they would swing their machine gun back towards us, and then we had another machine gun set up around the curve of this close to the small river that was running there. So we were firing back and forth there most of the night.
When you say your machine gun, was it a captured?
Yeah, they captured our, we had an observation post up at the top, and they overran the position and took over the machine gun.
And how long did this, I mean, what was that night like, I guess? What?
It was a lot of confusion and a lot of weird noises, and we just stayed together, and we were afraid that, I wasn't afraid that they would pull out, but we were afraid that if our troops pull out, we'd be left up there alone, but we had confidence they would stay.
And how long did this battle ultimately last?
Just until the next morning. And then we figured we beat them off. Then it was like maybe a battalion that was left hanging, and they just disappeared. And we thought and that's what we were essentially looking for when we went further north, that the come in contact with that battalion. And the word was that once we got a hold of the battalion and did away with them, then we'd be home for Christmas.
And that was something.
And because intelligence was very lacking up there, and our leadership didn't pay attention to really what was going on. And that was our Army leadership, not the Marine.
If it was Marine leadership, it would have been a different
story. Oh, yeah, without question.
So how, after the Battle of the Chosen Reservoir, how, where did you proceed from there? Or?
Okay, we went up to, we first ran into the Chinese, a place called like Sudong Valley, which is pretty much down at the bottom of the mountain. And then afterwards, we moved up in a place called Kota Ri, and then from there we went up to a place called Hagaru, and we made that our divisional command post up there. And then we went up to further, about 12, 13 miles by, it was probably 20 miles to the curved roads and everything, that place called Udamni, which was as far as we went. And then we didn't decide, I guess the Chinese figured that we'd gone far enough, and we didn't know how many, there was like, I've heard from 120,000 to 200,000 Chinese troops in the area. And they kept putting up roadblocks, and they finally decided that we would go back down to Hagaru Ri. And they had built an airstrip there, and that's where we went.
And what, I guess, when did the Korean War end?
It didn't end there. Our whole operation there ended about the end of the first week in December, I guess. And on the way back down from Udamni to Hagaru, on the main road, we would have the troops would go on the road, and when we would run into a roadblock, we would have to go up on the hill to push the Chinese off the area, and then back down and get them moving again. It was only like 13 miles, but it took us like 3 or 4 days to come down there. But I got, the weather was like 35 to 40 below zero, and most of the fellows had some type of frostbite. It was Actually, we didn't know it at the time, but for the fellows that were wounded, they didn't bleed to death. You know, they used the blood was coagulated by the cold, and so that really helped them. It's hard to tell them that, though.
So what was miserable for someone not wounded actually helped save the lives of the other guys?
I'm sorry.
So the weather was miserable to fight in, but it actually helped save.
Oh yes.
Save lives.
Yes. And the Chinese had just as bad a time with the weather as we had. I have some pictures I'll show you. Their feet are just masses of flesh. I don't know how you would call it. But we had the shoe packs, and we just didn't have the right gear for that type of operation. Why we got frostbite was because if you had you exerted yourself going up and down these hills, and then when you had to stop and either for a firefight or whatever, then the sweat just froze. That's why they had a bad time with the frostbite.
Did you have any issues or running any of that?
Frostbite and gunshot wound.
I wasn't aware that you had been hit. When did you?
And coming back down from New Damn Knee about 3rd or 4th of December, I guess. I just came back, and everybody was going up and down the hills to keep the main supply route open. And as soon as we get it to a stop, then we go up the hill and come back down. And I was standing there holding onto a truck. The truck moved out, and I didn't. And one thing, they didn't want to be, and it would, anybody that was wounded, then they would put them on the truck, or a Jeep, or whatever. Nobody wanted to go in the truck because they were afraid that you'd freeze to death. Unfortunately, I didn't freeze to death.
Where were you hit?
In the leg.
Do you remember, what does it feel like to be?
I didn't know I was hit. I didn't know I was hit until I just couldn't move. And when we got down to Haigaru, and we thought we'd be in pretty good shape because I was our division command post, but they had been overrun the night before. So they were, but we had the, they protected the airstrip, and somebody, they helped me down to the sick bay and first aid station, and they said, "Hey, do you know what you have here?" They said, "We got to get you out of here," and they were lining fellows up to fly them out, and I was flown out on a light observation plane from there down to Hungnam. As we were taking off, you could hear there's a fabric on the plane, and you could hear the fabric being hit by these rounds of small arms fire.
And that was your last, I guess, last couple seconds of war, and you were able to.
That's right. Then we went down to Hungnam, and from there, were checked over by a doctor down there, and we were put on a plane over to Tokyo. To an army hospital, actually, in Fukuoka. And there, from there he went by train, hospital train, over to the naval hospital, Yokosuka Naval, at the Navy base there in Yokosuka. And from there, let's see, I went by, to from there to Midway, and then to Hawaii, then to Oakland, California, the Oakland Hospital there, and then from the Oakland Hospital to Springfield, Illinois, and then from there to the Westover Air Force Base in Massachusetts, and then from there to the Naval Hospital in Philadelphia.
And that was it for you?
And that was it. And from there, I went to, I was actually on essentially light duty, so I reported into the Philadelphia Navy Yard as a Marine barracks there, and I was there until my enlistment was up in a little over a year, I guess. I was still in the reserves, but I was off of active duty then.
And you didn't, at that point, you didn't want to continue, you didn't continue in the reserves either?
Until 1954, I guess. And I guess when was the war over? About 1953, I think.
Okay. So let's, if we can take a couple steps back and, you know, before you enlisted in the Marine Corps, what did you think war was, or what was your concept of war at that point?
It wasn't good. I had a lot of information from other people that were in there, and I never thought it wasn't fun or anything like that, you know. But it was just something that we had to do, that's all.
Were you ever scared? When you first, you know, in World War II, when you first went overseas and landed on this, when you were in this unfamiliar island, were you worried? Were you scared, or were you kind of just...
Scared. Very frightened. But putting up a false front, I guess.
Didn't want other people to see.
Didn't want other people.
But deep down, but inside, you were...
Inside, you're frightened. I think everybody was frightened.
What keeps everybody going then?
Spirit of Corps. They know that there's a job to do, and that's what basic training, and you're taught to rely on the guy next to you. That's all.
So even though you're horrified of what's going on, you don't want your buddy to know it, and you're not going to let him down.
Oh no. Never.
In World War II and in Korea, were you with a set number of guys? Did you have any close friends?
Oh yeah, a lot of close friends. And they still, every once in a while, I still think of them. But they're, that's the type of, you know, that happens in the military. You make close friends, and then sometimes you lose them.
Do you remember your first moments of combat? Do you remember being in combat for the very first time?
Yes. I guess it was in Korea, down south. Especially when we were up with... Supporting Arms Command, and all of a sudden they say, "This is it." Yeah. And you can see the enemy, and you know they're trying to stay away from you also.
So Korea was the first time you really experienced some intense combat.
Yeah.
At what point then, you know, you went through combat with your friends. What's it like to lose someone that you're there to, you know, you're there to protect?
Well, you can't dwell on it too much. And it really doesn't sink in until later, I think. But you just have to keep going, and if you have a replacement, then you have a new friend.
Do you remember, did some of your friends not make it home?
Oh, yes, sir. A lot of them didn't. And some were really good friends, and others, you know, just friendly and in a passing way, that's all.
Did you, you know, you're a close buddy of yours falls, do you ever think either I'm next or I, you know, I'd rather me than him?
I think no matter what, that as sorry you were that your friend got hit, I think you're always glad that was him and not you.
You know, talking, I guess we'll switch gears a little bit and talk about, you know, being a forward observer. What's it like to have that kind of power essentially at your control? I mean, you're able with a command to call in an enormous amount of firepower.
It's a good feeling to know that you have it, that you can call on that. And our 4.2 mortar was a heavy mortar. Like normally, the Marines have the 60 millimeter and 81 meter mortars at a company level. We were a regimental weapon, actually. Like a 4.2, I guess it's closer to a 105. It's a little bit larger than a 105 howitzers. Very accurate. Ours would, except during the extreme cold weather, really affected the range. And when we were up in the mountains, I really didn't operate as a forward observer that much up there because the contour of the land, you try to fire your mortars and the rounds would, they just disappear.
So you would, I mean, you couldn't see them, they'd go over the next hill or something.
They were very not effective that way. It was more effective using the smaller mortars as 61 millimeter mortars, I guess, were the most efficient weapon.
So the mortars that you controlled, those were more of a permanent setup.
Yes, they're very, very heavy, and you needed jeeps to transport the ammunition and the mortar itself. It's very heavy.
And this is opposed to the mortars that you would see, you know, you commonly see guys carrying on their backs if it's a two-man or three-man team.
Because they were very mobile, and you could set them up a lot quicker than we could.
So when you're walking around as a forward observer, obviously the mortars are pretty much well in the rear. They're
in the rear, right?
Are you, and you're in front of the, you know, the rifle companies that are advancing?
Usually you're with a rifle company, and that's under normal. That other supporting arms command, that was just down in South Korea. That was a different type of war down there. But when you're right with a company, then you can take the direction from the company, your company commander. He would want you to bring your weapons, you know, in certain areas. So you would operate more like a artillery piece. In fact, when we were all the way up at UDMD, our mortars were set up with the artillery. And then when we would fire up there, we would just fire it in different sectors and not know what happened. Usually it's good to see, you could follow your rounds by leapfrogging your rounds with white phosphorus, you know, white smoke to you can see where your weapon, where it was hitting, that They were just firing up in a separate section.
So the guys that you were with, the riflemen that you were with, did they see you as, you know, kind of not a just a protector, because you were able to call in this heavy equipment? Did they treat you separately?
No, they're pretty much a lot of harassment, but I had good friends in the different companies also. Like a good friend of mine was in, he had a heavy weapons company with heavy machine guns. Every once in a while I would see him and ask how, you know, how are things and everything.
So let's talk about some of the best memories you have then from Korea. What are some memories that, you know, after all these years, you could still relive?
Well, most of the time they would, the sense of humor, they always would have their humor. I was up in at UDMD, and I had a radium in there, also, and they set me up. But they said the radio wasn't working. I said, well, just change the battery. And they said, I can't get the battery out. So he's playing around. So I took my gloves off and grabbed the radio. And at 30 below zero, my hands froze to the radio. So then a good friend of mine, he was a sergeant, his name was Atkinson. And he said, Logan, he said, I'm going to get them to chase me in. He said, when they come by, you whop them with a ring. So that was a little bit of humor they had.
How did you get unstuck from?
We had a warm-up tent. And with these 55 drums of diesel. And I took the whole radio in, set it on the stove actually until finally come apart. But
I imagine you got some funny looks walking around with the radio stuck to your hands to get to that.
Yes, but if you pulled it off, you would rip the skin right off your hand. That's some of the tricks they played. One trick we pulled on one of our platoon sergeants, this Atkinson and I. We had a hand grenade, and we emptied the powder out. And so then Atkinson was playing with a grenade, and I told him, just, you know, knock it off. You know, stop playing with a grenade. And I suddenly pulled the pin out. I said, now you've done it. Put the pin back. I said, here, give it to me. Well, I just hit the grenade, and the spoon came off, and what we didn't know was this other platoon sergeant was standing there. His name was Boisenall, and he thought the grenade was a live grenade, and he stuttered for about 3 weeks. Yeah, I mean, things like that you want to remember.
Who was Atkinson?
He was a sergeant that I met actually on a train to California. He was from the Washington, D.C. area, and his wife worked for the Marine Corps headquarters. We became friends, and actually, when we were in California, he always says, he said, I don't know why he got out of the Marine Corps. He said, I'm having a ball. He said, I'm running around with women, getting drunk all the time, drinking. He said, I love it. He said, I don't know why I got out. It just so happens that when we were, and that's what he used to keep on saying, I don't know why I ever got out. And when we were making a landing at Incheon, it just so happens we hit the rail at the same time. And I hear this voice say, hey, Logan. I look up and he says, now I remember why. But I mean, how to keep your sense of humor. And they all have it.
Is that what keeps you, I guess, positive during, you know, during 40 below zero temperatures and you know, intense fighting?
Nothing will keep you going with 40 below zero. It just everything's miserable. Nothing works. You can't. If you could light a fire, you couldn't cook the food anyway. Because when they would, you know, sometimes they would just cook. We had sea rations, and the sea ration would be burned on the bottom, not bad in the middle, and still frozen on the top. So
you just couldn't win with the temperatures.
No, temperature. And don't forget that. That's 40 with winds and everything else. That chill factor is probably around 80 or 90 degrees below zero.
So these 10 degree days we have here are nothing.
They're still cold. They still hurt.
What were some of the worst times you went through?
Well, that was probably the worst route. To get into, we had a safe haven at the division command post, and they had been overrun, and we thought we were very safe and in good shape. Well, we were really, because we got the units together, the first. Not exactly the 1st Division, the first Regiment, because they were down in Cota Ree, and we were just the 5th and the 7th Regiment up in Udamne. And at Hagaru was basically our leadership.
Keep going. We'll give it 1 second there.
I don't have to think.
Okay. Just let, so the microphone, the sound of the phone doesn't override your voice.
Oh, okay.
Let that run through. Give me a second. Almost done too. I have a couple more questions, and then we'll be done with this.
Okay.
So as you were saying,
where was I?
I think we were talking about some of the worst.
Oh, the worst, and we thought that, you know, we would be really in good shape when we got back to Hagaru, and we weren't aware that they were under fire. And with that area, with the mountains like that and the hills, you could be on a hill and somebody be in a terrible firefight on the next hill, and you wouldn't know it. Just if the wind weren't blowing in the right direction or anything, you wouldn't even know that they were in a fight. And It was amazing when we found out how many. Well, we were against an army. Like there's, I'll show you a book in there. There's like 6 or 7 divisions. We only really had 2 full regiments at Udamne, and that was splintered also because we had different. We had dropped off a couple companies before that. The leadership is what I think pulled us through throughout the whole affair. Individual leadership by that, and whether it be a private first class or a sergeant or an officer, we had the leadership.
I imagine you're very thankful for the, you know, your commanders, and you thought it, did it, in your opinion, did everybody do a good job, and could you have done it without the support of everybody else?
No, you couldn't. It was a feeling that your leadership was behind you, and that was our leadership. I think with the Army, they had a problem with their leadership, and some of their leadership was very good, but they just, their leadership wasn't too good. They fought like, they had problems and fought like crazy up there. They just, and some of the, when they were off to the east of Goshen, actually. And it was part of the 7th Division, and they didn't have all of their regiments up there with them, so they had a problem. They had a big problem with their leadership. They when they part of them got back into Hagaroo, they put Marine NCOs in charge of their companies.
That says something.
That says a lot. But they fought. So you can't, they were there.
Do you think your experience, because you said you were an NCO as well, you were a sergeant. Yeah. Do you think your experience being an NCO and also the what you saw from your leaders, do you think that helped you down the road, as you started to advance in the civilian world as a leader?
Oh, sure. I think, I talked to a lot of fellows, and they praised our leadership, and they said that's how they survived, was through our leadership. That may have been over a couple beers at Branson.
Do you when you were done with the military, did you mention it to anybody when you re-entered the civilian world? Did you tell anybody you were a Marine or?
Oh, yeah, we talked about it, but never really pushed it that much.
You wouldn't, it wasn't like it is today in terms of being a veteran. Was it, today being a veteran, you go to the grocery store and somebody sees, a Marine Corps hat.
And oh, yes. No, they didn't. Now, a Marine Corps hat was different. You're always, if you wore your, like Barbara wouldn't like me to wear my little red hat when I go down the shore, because another Marine would always stop and talk to you.
She wanted to just enjoy vacation sometimes.
Right. So, but if you notice that with the Marines, they're not ashamed of saying that they were Marine.
Do you, do you tell people, do you volunteer the information that you're a veteran and a Marine, or is that more for things like the veteran breakfast?
That's like at the veteran breakfast, and I belong to the Marine Corps League and American Legion, and we have camaraderie there, like with Doug Forsyth and Leon Anderson. We have a thing going with all the time. So.
Do you, when people find out that you are a veteran, they say thank you? How does that make you feel?
Makes me feel good. That feels good.
And talking to the kids and high school students and grade school students, do you think they? How do you tell them what it means to be a veteran and what you went through? How do you relate that to somebody that young?
Without any, I'm not a blood and guts guy to start with. Some fellows would talk, it gets pretty gory and everything the way they talk. I don't think that's necessary. But I appreciate talking to the kids. They have a lot of good questions. A lot of good questions.
A common title that is given today for all veterans is hero, or heroism. For you, what's your definition of a hero or heroism?
The heroes didn't come back, as far as I was concerned. And I would never fall into that category.
Could you name a few of your heroes then?
I had a just a young fellow, and he was always looking to get into a firefight and gung-ho, wanted to do this, wanted to do that, and he got killed on a mountain, on a mountain there. He had the machine gun that they took, they overran, and he was killed at that time. And I felt sorry, really sorry for him. And a couple others that I was surprised. Another fellow was a good NCO. He was a corporal, and he was shot by a friendly fire. Just going around one of his mortars there, and somebody mistook him for somebody else, and he got shot. I felt bad for them. But
do you think of those guys today? Do those memories still stick with you?
Sometimes.
What about PTSD? You know, when from World War II and Korea, even Vietnam, PTSD wasn't something that is acknowledged like it is today. Did you have issues?
No, not really. No, I don't think I did. Show you how much I know.
I guess my final question is, what kind of advice could you give to my generation and the future generations on, you know, I guess what advice would you give to myself and future generations?
Mind your mother and father. I think your parents have a lot to do with it. They keep you on the straight and narrow, and I think we try to keep our kids on the straight and narrow. And even if they wander off, we found that they all come back. So,
do you think respecting your, you know, do you think adhering to that advice is what led to your generation being called the greatest?
I think for the greatest generation, that was, they did their job, and they came back, and they just picked up essentially where they left off. That's it.
Anything else you could add? Anything else you want to talk about that we didn't cover?
I did a pretty good job.
I think we wrapped it up. Okay. Yeah. Let me turn these off, and then we will break everything down.